Hello, my name is Jens von Pilgrim. I present N4JS, which is a static and sound type system for JavaScript. I always say ECMAScript. ECMAScript is the official name of JavaScript. It's interchangeable. Before I start explaining the language in detail, you may ask why did these guys develop a new language when there is already JavaScript and also other JavaScript-like languages. Our company, Number4, develops a cloud-based application platform for small businesses. And to translate this to technology, we have these layers. We have applications which use a runtime. It's a framework to access our server-based platform, which delivers the services. And this runtime is large. It contains approximately 3,000 classes. And this runtime is written in N4JS. When you write a framework with this amount of classes, then you really need types, at least that's my opinion. You need content assist. You want to get errors as soon as possible at compile time, not at runtime. So this is why you need a static type system. And our apps are running in the browser or on Node.js. So for that reason, we absolutely needed JavaScript. JavaScript has no types, but Java has. So the idea is that you compare Java and JavaScript a little bit. In Java, you have a strongly typed system, and you have class or interface-based inheritance and object orientation. While in JavaScript, you have dynamic types. You can also say at compile time, you really don't really have types. There's no type checking at compile time. And you have a prototypal object orientation. This is the object orientation is a little bit different than in Java. And our idea was to bring the type system of Java and its type safety to JavaScript. That is our primary focus, so that we have a sound type system on JavaScript side. But then the challenge is that we want to keep all these typical JavaScript idioms in N4JS, then you can use these typical JavaScript idioms there. So the foundation of our type system and of user-declared types in general is, as in Java, classes. Actually, the current JavaScript version, ECMAScript 2015, knows classes as well. They introduced this last year. And all the major browsers and their JavaScript engines now support classes. So classes is not something new to JavaScript. It's now natively in JavaScript as well. And what we did is we used this class concept of JavaScript. We also added a new feature which is not known to JavaScript, that is interfaces. So in N4JS, you have interfaces as in Java. You also have methods with default implementations. That's a bit similar to Java 8. Our default implementations are a little bit more powerful. You can define fields as well and even private methods. Stuff like that. The constructor there, for example, that's a little bit different to Java. If you look at the class, that's simply the ECMAScript syntax for class with the constructor. You can have single inheritance in ECMAScript as well when you have classes. We have this in N4JS as well, so it's similar to Java again. When you have methods, you have can override them, and in N4JS, we even borrowed the override annotations when you override a method. So this is all very, very similar to Java. But then there are some differences, and they start very quickly. You discover them very quickly. For example, you have static members as well. So you have static members and instance members. And in, oh, the slide is a little bit messed up here. Sorry for that. How did this came? I don't know. In Java, when you have static members, you don't have, for example, a static method, you don't have override for a static method. Because the method is static, that's it. In JavaScript, you can have static polymorphism. This is because in JavaScript, you have the prototype chain. This is the inheritance chain, basically. But you also have a chain of the constructor functions which create the class. And for that reason, you have you can override static methods. And in N4JS, you can access these constructor functions, which are kind of representing the meter type of a class. This is not really the class that you have in Java, this metered class, but it's really the class itself. And you can access these static methods via these meter classes. You see this here in the example. Here we have a static method f, it's overwritten. You can directly call it as in Java via the type here. But you can also use the type here, d, to pass it to a function which expects a type, this is the meter type, and then call the method there. And with this trick you have static polymorphism as well, which is sometimes very convenient if you have creator methods or something like that. Another difference to Java is that you don't have method overloading in JavaScript. There cannot be method overloading because you don't have types in JavaScript. So the way how we model that then is we introduced union types. A union type is very simple. It's you have a variable, and if you say it's a union type, then the type at runtime is simply one of the types of that union. If you have a union type, you can directly access members which are present in all the types of the union. For example, here you have a class A with method AFG, class B with method F, and then you have here this union type with this pipe here in the middle. So R or B, it's R or B, you read it like that. And then you can access the F method because it's present in both classes, but you cannot access G because it's not present in B. If you want to access this, then you have to cast and use instance of operators and things like that. We also have intersection types with this kind of the symmetric opposite of that. And intersection types, you probably also know them from Java. You can have this in type variables. Yeah, and here in the bottom, you see how we use this to emulate method overloading. So this is in Java. We use N4JS syntax, but it would be Java. So you have log with a string, log with an error. And in N4JS, you simply say you have a message with string or error, and then you have to do the instance of check here inside this method. One thing that is very different in JavaScript, and this is really one of probably the most important features of JavaScript, is that functions are first class objects. This makes JavaScript so functional. And when you have functions as first class objects, you have to model them somehow in your type system. And for that reason, we have function types. The function type syntax is a little bit similar to this error expression we also have in Java now. In JavaScript, you use the fat error instead of a single error. So this lambda expression syntax. For example, here I have a callback. I can pass this a callback function to another function as an argument. And I say that this callback function needs to accept the parameter of type B and returns void. And then inside my function, I can call this. This is standard JavaScript. We only add the type annotation here. And then you can call this function here with a lambda expression here directly because we have the type declared here, our type inferencer. Infers the type here of the parameter P. We don't need the type annotation here. So we know that P is a B, and then we can access the members of B. So this is completely type safe, and you don't even need to write types here anymore. This function subtyping is a little bit tricky because it takes certain characteristics of JavaScript into account. For example, you can here this method expects the parameter p of type b, but you can also pass in a method here which takes no argument at all. Because if you have a method that expects an argument, then if you have another method that expects no argument, this method is a subtype of this other method or function. Because if you pass a method in JavaScript to a function that doesn't expect an argument, no harm is done. There's no problem with that. So this is why this is working here. If you pass in another method that, for example, expects a string here, then it's not working anymore because the string is not B here. So we have this type checking for function types, and you already see some parts of the relatively powerful type inferencer of N4JS. The overall idea is that you write your types at certain places when you declare things, but when you use it later on, you rarely have to type anything anymore because everything is inferred. Yes. Yeah.
You also have covariance on parameter types.
So yeah, there are some slides.
The name B and the type signature of the lambda, say P of B.
Um, here. Here I don't use any P. It's empty.
Yes, but if you name it S instead of P.
I don't need the name here. Okay. It's just to simplify things a little bit. Yeah, you don't need the name of the parameter in the type expression. Yeah, that's true. And here we have this contravariance of parameters. We will see this later on. I have slides for that. Generics. Another very, very powerful thing when it comes to type system is generics. Also in Java, we have generics. And N4JS has really the same syntax, same semantics as Java 8. Not Java 7, it's really Java 8. We even use the same algorithms internally to infer certain things for type variables. So N4JS has the same powerful generic system as Java 8. Actually, it's a little more powerful because we had to extend it for support union types, intersection types, and other things we introduced in N4JS. You will see them later. So these generics completely fit into the world of N4JS. We have things like generic classes, generic methods, but of course also generic functions. I mean, you don't have functions in Java, but we have generic functions in N4JS. Now we have this term variance. We already heard about that. In Java, you probably have run into that already. It's not really new. You have a class A and B extending this class A. This is my working material here, class A and B. Then you have some generic type here, very simple type, optional T, that just takes a T in the constructor, and then it has a getter to return this T thing. And then you have a function that expects a parameter with an optional of A. Now the problem is, if you have a class that is an optional of B, you cannot pass it to this function here. You will get an error here, because although B is a subtype of A, the optional of B is not a subtype of optional of A. That's what we call the variance problem. And one trick to solve this in Java is called useSide variance, because you define how you use this thing at the useSide, where you use it. And in Java, you use wildcards for that. This question mark extends something, or in the other way, something super of something else. So in this case, we have this question mark extends expression. This is similar to Java. And that enables us to pass in an optional of B here, because the question mark extends, optional question mark extends B is a subtype of optional question mark extends B. The effect of this wildcard is that we can only read from this A here, from this P here later on. So we only can call a getter there, for example. And this effect is like T, this type variable here you saw here, this one. It's only read inside, except for the constructor. And there's another concept to solve this variance problem. It's in Scala. They use definition side variance. So instead of defining this question mark extends everywhere where you use this thing, you can simply say at the declaration time, or at the definition side, that this parameter T, this type variable, is only used in methods when it's returned as an out parameter. And if you mark this class with an out T, then the optional of B becomes a subtype of optional of A. And in the end, it's the same result in both cases, and both have some advantages and disadvantages. And in N4JS, you can use whatever you want, what's the better fit for your use case. Now we're so deeply into typing. And when I mentioned the Java type system, I always implicitly use the notion of nominal typing. This is the default in N4JS as well. And in nominal typing, you have to say that you have to explicitly state that a type is a subtype of another type. This is the nominal thing. You have to nominally declare that. So for example, here you have a method class A, class B, not related. So you get an error here because B is not a subtype of A. Well, that's nominal type, and that's what you expect. This is almost the same code, but you get a completely different error message. You say the error message states that B is not a subtype of A, and there we have a tilde here, because there's a method foo missing. And you see, if you compare these two things, well, here we have foo and here we have bar. So yeah, there is method foo missing. And the result of that, we use this tilde here to switch the typing strategy from nominal typing to structural typing. And in structural typing, you define a subtype a little bit differently. You say that a subtype of a class is, or you know this probably from duck typing, it's another name for structural typing. If it quacks like a duck, swims like a duck, then it's a duck. So a subtype needs only to have the members of the supertype. So let's have a look at the fixed version here. In the nominal world, we need to explicitly mark that B extends A. And now when we override foo here, we rename foo, bar to foo here, then in N4JS you even have to explicitly state this override statement. We will see later on why we enforce that. In structural typing, now we have this structural modifier here. So now we say that A is used in structural mode. We have method foo here, we have method foo here, and now it's working because both have the method foo. When I say that we compare the members of a type to compute whether it's a subtype or not, a structural subtype or not of another type, we only consider the public members. This is why I had to add this access modifier here, which we also have introduced in N4JS. We have public and private access modifiers, and also some others. This is what we call definition side structural typing. That means in all the cases where you use A, you use the structural typing strategy. But there's also another way of doing that. Same thing, almost the same thing, but now it's U side. So in this case, normally you use nominal typing for A, but only in this method you accept structural typing, which is kind of convenient because then you can just, usually you use nominal typing because it's a bit more powerful. We will see this in the next slides. And this is here. What's the difference between nominal and structural typing? Because from the user's point of view, it's often almost the same. It's basically interchangeable in many cases. Let's refactor the code a little bit. So we rename here this method foo to bar, and now we get in both cases errors. That's great because, I mean, we have a sound type system, so we expect an error here. B extends A, but now this method foo doesn't override a method here anymore because we renamed it. So when we call this method here later on via polymorphism, et cetera, we have changed the semantics, even if it still works because it's nominal typing, so B actually inherits the method foo. But now we get the error because we enforced this override thing, annotation. In structural typing, it's different. We rename that, we don't get an error here because B is not related to A at all. That's very convenient. That's the one of the advantages of structural typing. And then we get an error here when we use it because now B does not any longer provide this method bar that we need here. So in both cases, we get an error. So we could say, oh, great, why do you care? The reason is that the error locations are differently. So let's have a look. When we change this method bar here, then this is often code that you have in your framework. And we provide a very large framework, this 3,000 classes thing. So we want to do refactorings there. And when we do a refactoring in our framework, or you provide a framework or library, then of course you want to see the errors that you produce there or the change of the semantics in your framework. So the nominal typing here already shows us the error location inside our framework part, while the structural typing error is on the client code when you use this thing. So with nominal typing, it's much better for frameworks because then you get the errors more at the place where you really cause the error and not at the use side. But because both have these advantages and disadvantages, we provide both, so you can use both. Enough about type system. Let's have a look at the language from a more abstract point of view. In N4JS, we introduced the concept of components. You know that from Eclipse, it's like the bundles in Eclipse or Eclipse projects in your IDE. And you have an N4JS project, you also have a manifest file. It's almost similar to the manifest file of your Eclipse bundles, where you define the dependencies, like here, you have a project dependency here. An interesting side note is that these dependencies may refer to NPM packages. You know the node package management system. So you can add simply here name of an NPM package. And the IDE is even smart enough to automatically download the NPM for you if it's not on your machine already. Of course, the NPM stuff is usually normal JavaScript. It's not typed, but you can add type declarations to existing legacy code. Because we have this notion of components or projects, we even have a dedicated access modifier. It's called project. That's actually the default access modifier, and it's similar to the package access modifier in Java. So everything that you write without a modifier, it's only visible inside your project, which really helps. Then you have this API validation stuff and so on in Eclipse projects, and here we have the project modifier. Quick look at the IDE. The IDE, if you're used to the JDT, then this IDE should look similar because we try to get as close as possible to the JDT IDE. We have made some changes. For example, we have smart working sets here. This is something that you use, it's very useful for large projects. You probably use work sets as well if you have a larger project and you have to define them manually all the time. It's completely annoying. In our case, we have smart working sets, so you can automatically sort the things by Git repository, project location, name filters, or in this case here by the N4JS project type. So you see we have different types of projects. I don't want to go into the details there. Of course, we have an incremental automatic builder, so we get the errors when you type, as in the Java IDE. We have quick fixes. We have a JUnit-like test support here. If you're a Java developer, you feel at home with N4JS. When we run the tests, by the way, we do this with Node.js. We also have internally support for Chrome, which will become public one day. We have much more features. I could spend hours now talking about more features and advertise the language a little bit, because what you saw is only really a small part, which is related to the type system. We have enums with a special flavor that is very useful here with string-based. So at runtime, there is no enum anymore. It's only the strings there. That's very convenient if you have to model legacy code, like the DOM API, for example. There you have a lot of strings used as enums. We have this async-await feature already built in, which will be part of the upcoming JavaScript versions. I don't know if you know that. Does anyone know this callback hell and the promise API of JavaScript? Then you probably know that this async-await really saves you a lot of trouble. We even have support for legacy code. So if your function has a certain pattern, which is common in JavaScript, so that the last parameter of a function is a callback method, then you can add a promisify annotation and use the async-await feature for this legacy code as well. We support this ECMAScript 2015 modules. This is in the syntax you have imports and exports. The ECMAScript standard only defines the syntax but not the module loader. That's very detailed format. Things we support CommonJS and System.js simultaneously. That is, when we compile the code, you can use it with both module loaders. You don't have to recompile it. We have type safe array and object restructuring. This is one of the new features of ECMAScript 2015. More features, polyfills. Do you know what a polyfill is, a dynamic polyfill or a shim in JavaScript? In JavaScript, it's very common when we had this change, switch from ECMAScript 5 to ECMAScript 2015, the API of the built-in types was already extended. So string had new methods and other classes had new methods. And then people wrote a polyfill, that is because you have prototype-based inheritance in JavaScript. You can change existing classes dynamically at runtime. You can just add a new method there. So people added new methods to this existing old ECMAScript 5 classes to behave like the new API in ECMAScript 2015. That's fine for JavaScript, but then you have to tell the type system that there are new methods to check that. And for that, we have the notion of dynamic polyfills. We also have the notion of static polyfills. So while the dynamic polyfills are added at runtime, so the new methods are added at runtime to the existing prototypes, the static polyfills do that at compile time. Now you can ask, why do you need that? You need that when you use model-driven development approaches where you have models and then you generate code from that. And in our case, we generate large parts of our framework from other models. And then we want to manually enrich these models. You maybe know this from EMF. You have your EMF models, but then you want to add new methods to your generated EMF class. And how do you do that? In our case, we have the static polyfills to manually enrich the generated code, for example, which is really kind of powerful. And it bridges the semantic gap that you always face in the area of model-driven development. Another thing we borrowed from the Java world is dependency injection. It's similar to Google Juice. You as a Eclipse programmers, you should know that already, this annotation here. We have this in N4JS as well. We even have validation then. There's something that is missing in Java at the moment. So if you have a class that has an injected member, you don't want to create it with new, because then the member is not injected. And in N4JS, you get a warning there on error. We have a special notion of test projects. So finally, you can test your private methods as well in a separate project. And I could continue that. That's enough for this. Now I'm a little bit running out of time, so very quickly, some comparisons to TypeScript, because do you know TypeScript? Does anyone of you know TypeScript? It's more or less the same approach as N4JS. So that's the same problem. JavaScript added sound or a static type system for that. In N4JS, we decided that type safety is our primary focus, and we try to support JS idioms as good as possible. But we didn't want to break this type system. In TypeScript, they did it the other way around. They wanted to support all the JS idioms there, even if that means to break the sound, the type system. So in short words, the TypeScript sound, the type system of sound, TypeScript is not sound. That is, you get errors even if you don't expect them. One of the differences there is the AnyType. This is a little bit similar to the object type in Java, so everything is a subtype of Any. In N4JS, because Any is the subtype of supertype of everything, you cannot do anything with Any. You don't know which methods it has. In TypeScript, you can do everything with Any. That's very convenient if you have legacy code, but of course, if you can do anything with something you don't know nothing about, it's very likely that you run into problems. The other thing is, and now we have this parameter covariance thing, is function subtyping. So I already had this example here with this function type, expecting an A here. And now you want to call this foo method with a B. And we know that this doesn't work, because this is here breaking when you have this greet thing. And if you call it here in the foo, then you get an error. And this is exactly what's happening in TypeScript. By the way, the syntax of N4JS and TypeScript is almost similar. So this is N4JS and TypeScript code. It's exchangeable. And so with this snippet here, we get a type error at runtime in TypeScript. But we get an error here at compile time with N4JS, because N4JS uses function parameter contravariance. That's the thing. While in TypeScript, you have function parameter bivariance. This is one thing in functions, but the other thing is when it comes to method overriding, and then it becomes really severe. Because now you have a class here expecting with a foo of a parameter A, you override this, you subclass this class and override this method, and now you have a more specific parameter here. This is not allowed in Java, this is not allowed in N4JS, but it is allowed in TypeScript. And then you get an error at runtime. And this thing violates the substitution principle. I don't know if you know that this is one of the foundations of object orientation, that you have the substitution principle. Subtype should be used the same, should be able to be used in the same way as the supertype. So, to wrap up a little bit, N4JS is an Eclipse technology. It's based on Xtext and Xpect. 3 years ago, I had a talk about this, how we did this internally. It's using X-semantics for the type system. Everything is based on EMF. We're using UMF as well to set up our development environment. We're working closely together with the Xtext and X-semantics team, and there are also a lot of changes in Xtext were driven by the development of N4JS, for example, grammars, fragments in the grammar or things like that. The good thing about that is that we use this Eclipse technologies is that the AST, the abstract syntax tree, the type model, and everything is based on EMF. And that means that you can very, very nicely access these models. So if you want to develop your own language, tinkering with languages or extending some stuff, whatever, it's very, very nice to do that here with this EMF stuff. And so far, I think that we provide the only ECMAScript 2015 parser that is based on Java. Yeah, summary, N4JS, JavaScript is Java-style static and sound type system. The important thing is sound type system that makes it different from TypeScript. We have nominal structural typing, combining of view side and definition side variants, and more things that you need for large-scale development. It's implemented with Xtext and other Eclipse technologies, and it's open source. You can download it here from this website at the moment. We have a Eclipse project proposal still pending. And when you develop something with for N4JS, we have Oomph script to set this up. And if you have questions, here is my email. Just contact us. We are also running around here. Thank you very much. The problem about that is that this is a weird hack. You can ask Akos sitting there in the back. He implemented that, and it's really a hack because the Eclipse UI stuff, or the API, does not really provide the necessary means to add things like that. So we basically rewrote this whole working set thing, and it's still fragile. So yeah, we try our best to make it as stable as possible, and maybe maybe you can try this, but it's really, you have to change the API of Eclipse there. Yeah, maybe I should do this. Yeah.
Are people outside of number 4 using this?
What?
Are people outside of number 4?
Outside? Well, it's public since March, so you can download it. I don't know, we don't have that much downloads there. Not a big community yet. We didn't do much marketing. This is basically the first talk I gave about this. But at number 4, we used this for more than a year now. It's really stable now. We also have a very extensive test suite, more than 90,000 tests. So it's really, also it's a not that well-known project. It's a very stable project already. And if you want to use that, we're more than happy to provide support for you as well. That's absolutely no problem. The idea was that we copied the concepts of Java on purpose. So when you're a Java programmer, and I mean everyone learns Java at university at least, then you can use N4JS. I mean you need to know JavaScript of course, because it's basically JavaScript, right? But then you have learned the type system of Java at university, so there's no problem at all. These small things like union type stuff, etc., that's really very easy to learn. So there's really not a problem. We explicitly focused on that. So we kept track of that. Even if it sounds so complicated, if you use it, it's not that complicated at all. We have new employees and they work with N4JS after 2 or 3 days. That's really, we never really had problems with that. There was another question?
Yeah, just mentioned.
Okay. So we are already over time a little bit. So if you have more questions, I'm running around here. Oliver is a co-author of the presentation is also running around here, and you can ask the other guys from number 4, Kwang there. Thank you very much.